Greetings. We're very grateful for you coming tonight. I'm always looking to see how many new faces there are at these events, and each author seems to bring somebody new with them, and I always ask how many are here to benchmark books for the first time ever. Yeah, Kimball. I meant physically. we're grateful to have you come with us. I was talking to you, so don't misinterpret. Come on in. We've got chairs here, and where else than here? I don't know that our last, let's see, was Janet our last? Yeah, another blogger, active blogger, was our last author, speaker, and that was Jana Reese. Some of you were here for that. Some of you are regulars, and we're always glad to have you come and be with us. Benchmark Books, for those of you who are new to us, you're probably wondering why we're in an office building, for one thing, but there's a method to our madness of being in an office building, and I won't bore you with all the details, but it's what works for us the best. So, but to let you know, we are going to be expanding this store, getting more space, and as much as we love this 30-year-old carpet, we're going to replace that and add some fixtures and really spruce up the place. Come on in. And let's see, where else have we got chairs? We've got a couple here. Let's see. I don't know if you can come here. You can squeeze back in there. And yeah, we're going to give it a kind of a facelift. And this year is our 25th year in business, so we're excited about that. We want to go on for at least another 75 so we can have our 100th. And I may not be here for that one, Chris, but Chris will be. I want to introduce our staff really quick. I don't always do that, and I think I shortchanged them. But my son Christopher, or Chris Bench, one of the 269 employees, as well as store manager, he's head of security and intimidation. His younger brother Landon, come on here so they can see you. Come on. Okay. And Brian Buchanan, who is also, he's 6'9", and so people assume he's my other big son, but he won't admit to it, and it's not true anyway. But and then Ann Wild. Been with me for how many years?
Since you were in business. 20,
yeah, since I was in business. So I really appreciate them very much, and they make this organization go. And any of you who have come in or have called on the phone, you've talked to them, and if they haven't treated you really nicely, let me know. Really grateful for them. This is I'm trying to think if there's there's one other thing I was supposed to say. Anyway, we are privileged to have with us tonight Samuel Brown, Sam Brown to most of us, who has just written an intriguing book. I've been working on some other books lately, and I just started on this. And I just thought, well, it's a book about Mormonism and death. And that is just so shallow and so inaccurate, because there's so much more to it. And he's gonna explore that with us. But I've known Sam for quite a while. He's I always feel a little intimidated around him because he's so much smarter than I am. But that's not really unusual either. Think about it. Probably everyone in here is smarter than me. But he's very eloquent and articulate. He's a good writer. He is, I'm just going to tell you a few of the basics about him. He is an ICU physician, medical researcher, and cultural historian. He's the assistant professor of pulmonary and critical care medicine and division associate in medical ethics and humanities at IMC and University of Utah. Boy, that's a mouthful, and only he could deserve that. He got some excellent reviews on this book. In fact, I just learned that he earned a starred review in Publishers Weekly, and they say, among other things, in this groundbreaking and important volume, Brown delves deeply into the many streams of thought that informed Smith's formulation of the life hereafter. This is must reading for students of the American religious tradition. None other than Richard Bushman said, this is a book purportedly about the dead and the conquest of death in early Mormonism. It is actually much more than that. Terrell Gibbons said, this is a brilliant work of intellectual and cultural history, and that it is superbly executed. A number of other very complimentary comments on Sam's book. We are really glad to have Sam with us to talk to us, and we don't usually have the little extra here of the audiovisual, and so we're going to hope and pray that everything works. This is being filmed tonight. It will be on YouTube. If you're camera shy, camera is right there on top of that fixture, so don't put your mug in front of it if you don't want to be on the internet. But we've gotten a really good response from people since we've been filming these events here at Benchmark Books. And so those who can't make it are able to see it and enjoy it later on. Our pattern is, after we hear from Sam, there'll be a question and answer period, and we will invite you to come up, and if you haven't purchased a book yet, if you'll do that at the front counter, and then Sam will be here at the table signing books, and we'll be happy to sign it or personalize it, whatever you'd like to do. And we would invite you to please browse the store and see what we have. For those of you who haven't been here before, we specialize in out-of-print, used, and some new. In this behind me here, we have new books on Mormonism, Mormon culture, Mormon thought, Mormon history, and we also deal in rare books as well. And so if you have, you know, 50,000 burning a hole in your pocket, I'd love to talk to you. So we do invite you to look around on these fixtures that you're sitting by here in the middle of the store on the table. We have sale books, and then we can give you, if you'd like, a little tour later. We can show you how the store's arranged. But, you know, get familiar with it. Please plan to come back another time, and don't stay away. And we will have future events just like this, and if you'd like to leave us your name and email address and so on, we'd be happy to notify you of future author signings. And the last person to come in pays for the refreshments.
I'll say the prayer.
We do have, actually we will have some refreshments afterwards out in the hallway here. So with that, I'd like to now turn the time over to Dr. Sam Brown.
Thanks, Kurt. It's an honor to be here, and I'm deeply grateful for the presence of a variety of people that have meant a lot to me and my family over the years, and want to acknowledge my favorite person, who's Kate Holbrook, the specialist in women's history for the LDS Church, who's here. I'm honored that she agreed to marry me some years ago, 12 or 15. I probably do know him by the way. I'm not so much with the reading. I feel like you guys all seem, with all these spectacles, to be highly accomplished readers. So rather than stand up in front of you and read a book at you, I thought I would interact more straightforwardly than that. Kurt suggested that I talk a little bit about where the book comes from, and then explore some of the topics within the book. So specifically, I thought I'd tell you a little bit about how I came to write this book and what this book has meant. And then I want to talk about something I call the Mormon chain of belonging, which is a key unifying narrative thread in chapter 8 and chapter 9 that I think is an important test case for thinking through the theology and experience of early Mormonism in a way that we have not yet done. So I go back now to my first publication in Mormonism, which was a paper that I wrote in the late 90s. I submitted it to Levina in 2000, and it was published in 2006. And I think that was a period when the Journal of Mormon History was a little bit slower on responding than they are now. It doesn't take 6 years anymore from initial submission to publication. At that point, I was doing bioinformatics and was doing computer code in a scripting language called Perl. And it occurred to me that I knew a little bit of statistics, and I'd been working on epidemiology. And why didn't I go through? Nick Liturski at that point had assembled all of the temple dedication prayers up to about 2000 and had a website. They had it, so I talked to him, and he said it was okay if I used the texts for research but didn't publish them myself. That honor went to some unscrupulous individual, I understand, not me. And I coded the different prayers for thematic elements and then looked statistically over time, how did things change? And one of the things that I noticed as I worked through these temple dedication prayers was in the very early period, the sense of angels as sacred representatives of biblical history was very, very acute and specific. And with time, over 150 years, much more commonly there was a general reference to angelic visitors or angelic ministrants. And I was thinking, what did it mean exactly to have that sort of a rhetorical change over time? It may have meant nothing, or it may have meant some change in the underlying theology. Kate and I, more than 9 months after our fateful encounter in the American Fork Temple, had a wonderful little child. 3 or 4 years later, in fact, we're very careful that way. And we went on vacation to Camden, Maine, which is a beautiful coastal old town in mid to southern Maine, and we ended up sort of lost in a beautiful colonial cemetery. And as the three of us, well, two of us walked and Amelia ran about and jumped on people's graves, things two-year-olds do, we read the inscriptions and the dates and occasionally the little mention of how they might have passed or what might have been their life experience, and had something of an inspiration that what distinguished Mormon beliefs about angels from traditional Christian or Jewish beliefs about angels was that angels were humans at a different level of their development. Whereas, for those of you that know, in almost every other angelology, they're totally different species. They're as different from humans as humans are from snails. So that struck me very sharply, that this was an important area of difference, and I wondered what it meant. Simultaneously, I was finishing up my residency and becoming an attending physician and was meeting people who were going to pass away. And some of my patients passed away. And it occurred to me as I watched that there were very few cultural resources available for people confronting that great transition in late 20th century, early 21st century America. And so it was a combination of those two questions. What are Mormon angels exactly, on a theological and cultural historical level? And what does it mean to die? And what does it mean to not have cultural tools or cultural resources to do it? And from those two questions or problems arose this book. And I started just by reading every Mormon primary source I could find up through 1845. Then I started looking at the secondary literature and cultural history or in death studies, broader religious history. It was initially called Forever Family, Early Mormon Theologies of the Kindred Dead. As I wondered what the unifying themes would be, it struck me that one of the key elements was a notion that's commonly associated with Neoplatonism, but is much broader than that, and it's the notion of correspondence, that there are sacred and potent associations between our own human lives and the life of the cosmos. And it struck me that part of what Joseph Smith was revealing to people was the possibility that Earth life contained crucial clues as to the nature of heaven life. So I inverted the phrase from the Lord's Prayer to play on that notion of correspondence. I showed it to a friend who's an actual accredited, famous, wonderful colonial historian, and he said, "I love you, Sam, but this book is terrible. It's just not worthy of you." And this was 06. That wasn't happy news for me at that point. I'd already written the dang thing, and I had a lot going on. But he made me pause and think, what can I do to make this book more relevant to people outside the Mormon tradition? I was making a lot of assumptions of the reader in terms of their understanding of where things had come from. So I spent a couple, 3 years reading another 150, 200 monographs and looking for new sources and revising it 10 times. And in 09, sent it into Oxford and was very grateful that Brett had told me it was terrible, because in its new state, it was a relatively rapid, positive reviews. They couldn't tell whether I was Mormon or not, and sort of irritated them, but it didn't irritate me. I wanted to be able to have that kind of neutral tone that would let me speak to multiple audiences. And then you send it in 09, and it turns out that even if it's a positive, quick response, they like it. It's 12 before it sees the light of day. This is what I proposed for the artwork originally. This is a local artist, Nathan Florence. He even agreed to airbrush it if the publisher felt that it was too scandalous for a potential audience. I was grateful for it. We pitched it to them, and no go. Then I thought maybe Leighton's Recovery of Persephone. This is Demeter, this is Persephone, this is Hermes. And I thought it was perfect because it invokes the Eleusinian mysteries, it evokes Hermeticism, which often is a sort of shorthand for Neoplatonism and the Western esoteric traditions. And I sort of liked it. It was pretty and sort of romantic looking. And it turns out they went to the BYU Art Museum and they typed in angel, and the first hit is the beautiful Minerva Tykert that you see on the cover now. So I was overruled yet again, and it was the right thing. Turns out, get overruled. Now I want to talk about something of substance, or I hope of substance, and introduce you to the construct of the chain of being. By show of hands, how many people have heard of the quote-unquote chain of being? It's okay, it's not embarrassing to not have heard of it. Okay, then I'll spend just a little bit more time being more clear about it. The chain of being is considered to derive from Plato. It sort of does. Aristotle, right? Aristotle is a minion, I think grad student is what they're called now, but back then they were called disciples of Plato, and Plato is a grad student of Socrates, and they're always fighting to show that they're more relevant than their mentor as they go along. And then Plato and Aristotle have this sort of complex dance as people interpret them, and Aristotelianism becomes dominant in Catholicism, and Platonism fades away a little bit, but then it recrudesces under the title Neoplatonism, which means something vaguely inspired by Plato, to be honest with you. It's a very nebulous term. But everybody who talks about it sends it back to Plato and Aristotle's interpretation of Plato. Fundamentally, it is like a tree of life, not in the sense of that the Blue People movie, but in the sense of a taxonomy of the different types of entities that exist. And it was a way for them to try to come to terms with pretty incredible biological diversity, right? They hadn't been deforesting, they hadn't been air polluting at that point. They still had plenty of species to observe. And the question is, why are there so many different species? And is there anything we can understand about the species that we see, including ourselves, that will explain something to us about God? It also allowed them to use what we would think of as biology now to talk about the meaning of the divine and the meaning of reality. It also, importantly, was a way for them to think through hierarchy. We pretend we're not hierarchical anymore in modern America, but just watch these presidential debates and the complex anger that is surrounding the current debates, and you'll see that we remain a hierarchical species. We've always been, and there was an attempt philosophically to understand the apparent gradations in a wide variety of attributes. And there are gradations in native intelligence in humans. Kate is smarter than Sam, apparently is smarter than Kurt, and so on down the line. But there are also gradations in anthropism, right? There's humans, then there's apes, and then there's, you sort of get down toward the zebras and hyenas, and they could sense that there were these gradations, and it appeared to them that they were certainly hierarchical. The other element that's important to understand is that for them, the superhuman or the suprahuman chain was very much alive and full of entities. And there were angels and archangels, and you know, if you really get into the sources and you're open about the traditions that you explore, there are hundreds of different types of angels and superhuman beings. And the chain of being was an attempt to encapsulate superhuman entities, humans, and their internal hierarchies, and then the natural, what we would call the biological world, and make them all fit together in perfect harmony. There are three core elements of the classic Platonic chain of being. One is called plenitude, and plenitude is the notion that everything that could possibly exist without being a self-contradiction does exist. There's no missing elements in this chain of being. Continuity says that it comes pretty naturally from plenitude, but fundamentally it's the notion that there is a continuity as you move from entity to entity. So you might say that a horse and a cow share that there are four legs and they chew their cud. No, horses don't chew their cud. So, I don't know, they're hairy and they're mammals, right? So they share that in common. And then as you move along further, you slowly make it to, say, an ape. And the notion of continuity is that you can identify elements in adjacent entities in that chain. And then there's gradation, which gets back to hierarchy, and that says all of these things that are interrelated can be arranged from lowest. And it turns out lowest was dust bunnies, plain old dirt, to highest, there are debates, it depends on how Gnostic you are, etc. But there was some chief angel figure. Now remember, in the chain of being, God is separate. God is not a member of that chain. So the top of the chain is some sort of archangel, and the bottom of the chain is dust. This is Robert Flood, who, those of you interested in Western esotericism know his name. Those of you not interested, his name is Flood. He's an interesting, odd fella, not immediately comprehensible to all of us. And this is his image of the whole of nature. And this is a depiction in reasonably astronomic, cosmological terms of the chain of being. And you see here the tetragrammaton, Yahweh, Jehovah, the name of God, which was felt to indicate God. And notice that God is separated, right? There's a little string here that connects you into this woman that doesn't represent, that seems to represent the notion of humanity. But the problem is, and these are the angels. So there are the levels of angels that are just under God. Then there's humans, and I don't want to embarrass myself since I'm on the tube of you. Whether this is specifically Eve or some sort of representation of humanity more generally, but you get into humanity, and then here you get into the mineral elements, you have all the different types of animals that exist, and you can see that you're going from more complicated to less complicated. So here we've got different kinds of humans, animals, plants, minerals, and I can't quite read that right now, so I'm not entirely sure what it says. But that's the basic notion. God, Yahweh, not a member, but clearly the source of it, superhuman, human, animal, vegetable, mineral. And when that 20 questions thing we played in the 80s and probably got played a million times, animal, vegetable, mineral, that comes from this classification of material existence. And they were felt to be very specifically part of it. So the superhuman chain, angels, demigods, archangels, if you're Gnostic, there's a demiurge. I won't bore you with the demiurge. If you believe fervently in the demiurge, I'm happy to talk to you. You'll sound a little bit more antique than modern if you do. This is another example. This is Ezra Stiles, who was the president of Yale just after the American Revolution. He was probably of his generation the best known American Christian Kabbalist. Kabbalah is a form of alphabetic mysticism that derives from medieval Jewish mysticism. Very fascinated with language, particularly Hebrew, Greek, and Latin, and fascinated with the meaning of the superhumans. So in Ezra Stiles' depiction, I think this is about 1796 or so, in his meditations or his journals, he indicated, this is again the tetragrammaton, that's just Greek for four letters, and it's YHWH. We say it Jehovah in America now. Fancy pants people will say Yahweh. Super fancy pants people will say YHWH. But that's what it is. It's the name of God in the Hebrew Bible. At the center is the tetragrammaton. And then, according to Stiles, these are the three orders of angels. They have different names depending on who's writing about them, but these are the three substituent classes of angels within the greatest angel order, and then another order, and then another order. And then according to Stiles, all are happy in God. These flagelli, these apparent spermatozoa, are meant by Stiles to indicate the tendency toward God. So this is the drawing of the human mind, intellect, spirit toward God. That's what these are. This is not some early National American sex ed class. This is very clearly his attempt to picture the dependence of all on God, represented by the tetragrammaton, and the hierarchical ordering of all entities. Now, this is just human and superhuman, as Stiles depicts it. The infrahuman chain, as I've suggested, goes from animals through the sea anemone, and this is what Wikipedia has to do with the sea anemone. Now remember from plenitude and continuity that there has to be missing links, right? There have to be things that keep you in normal, natural succession. And you look at a sea anemone, and your first response is, what is that? It's named after a terrestrial flower, the anemone, so it sort of looks like a flower, but it eats stuff, right? It's a little bit like if they talked a lot about the Venus flytrap. But sea anemone, for whatever reason, that's what they saw. Sea anemone was challenging because it seemed to be both animal and vegetable. But that ought to be a violation unless it's that perfect interstice between animal and vegetable. So you'll see, if you get really interested in it, you'll read a lot about sea anemones, which I understand don't taste very good, but fancy people. This is another example. This is now late medieval, early modern depiction. Valades, a 16th century author in a book called Christian Rhetoric. And this again shows you an image of God above the chain. These are the many different orders of angelic or superhuman beings. Good humans, mediocre humans, animal, vegetable, vegetable, mineral. The other thing I would point out is that in most of these depictions, there's a very clear cosmologic, astronomic, astrological element to it. They understood that the types of relationships they had to each other into the infrahuman biological world were copies or mirrors or similar to the interrelationships of the celestial bodies. So those of you that read much in early Mormonism, I think this is worth bearing in mind, that it was an established belief for millennia that the stars were associated with us. Now we think it's some Shirley MacLaine putting in a New York Post little horoscope, and oh, yeah, here it is, here it is. But back then, it was something, it was a way to understand who we are as humans. You look into the heavens, and you see the interrelationships of celestial bodies, and the fact that they have these perfect orbits, and they appear to be created by God. Well, that's true of us. We fit into a special order, and we're created by God. That was very important to the chain of being. Now, this was a very static construct, right? It was designed to allow hierarchy to persist. And that meant if you were born a sea anemone, you were a sea anemone for eternity, right? With no changing in you at all. And through the Middle Ages into the early modern period, that was absolutely maintained. Then there are a lot of things that change. We use enlightenment as a shorthand for a lot of different things happening all at once, not in any kind of coordination. But there is the arrival of what the main scholar of the chain of being, a guy named Lovejoy, calls the temporal chain of being. And the notion behind the temporal chain of being was that the interrelationships were fixed. The anemone would always be a little bit less than the slug, but would always be a little bit more than the terrestrial anemone, the flower. But the level of glory or majesty or gravity of all members of the chain would rise through time. So in 100 years, the anemone would have achieved the level of ontological glory or power that the sea slug had 100 years back. And the same thing true of the terrestrial anemone. And that was a very useful way to span this transition from an older antique worldview in which things are fixed, divine right of kings, you are the manor servant and you're not the duke, to a much more familiar notion to us of people having individual significance and of some flexibility. Temporal chain of being for certain thinkers entailed eternal progression. And that's what I talked about. Now, for humans, that means that in 10,000 years, you would be the equivalent of a certain order of angel today. That's the notion. The whole chain advances together. That is the conceptual context in which Joseph Smith begins to try to work through the relationships between his restored gospel and these older traditions. And this starts very young. One of the things I discovered from all this time in the primary sources is that in many respects, Nauvoo was an amplification, publicization, and concretization of doctrines, ideas, rituals that Joseph Smith had been working with since at least the early 1830s. The vision, it's now known to Utah LDS as Doctrine and Covenants Section 76, it's the vision of the afterlife in 1832. Joseph Smith scribes use the term the economy of God, an economy and his vast creation throughout all eternity. Those are gentle allusions to this notion of the divine economy of the biological and superhuman world that would have, to the listeners, invoked that tradition in which the chain of being had come. When Joseph Smith explained where the vision came from, he understood that there would be more kingdoms than one. Against the notion that all would be absorbed into the worship of the triune God in the afterlife, which was a fairly common notion among American Protestants and Catholics, Joseph suggested, well, maybe it's more complicated than all that. Maybe it's not just the merger into the worship of the triune God. And those of you that have read Section 76 of the Vision know that he talks then about kingdoms that are patterned on celestial bodies, celestial, terrestrial, telestial. And he is alluding to Paul in 1 Corinthians 15. This is Joseph Smith's Bible, the one that he owned. The Church History Library has it. Unfortunately, I'm such a purist that I used it, and it's all smudged out. But Paul says that there are celestial bodies and terrestrial bodies. Celestial is distinct from terrestrial. The glory of the sun is the celestial. The glory of the moon is meant to parallel the terrestrial. And then he says there's another glory of the stars. And Joseph Smith, as he read it, understood there to be a lacuna in Corinthians, that there was not a term that corresponded to the stars. And Paul had clearly set up this astrological or astronomical context. The other thing to bear in mind is that the Bible scripture most commonly for 1600 years associated with the chain of being was this. It had it all, right? It had the gradations, it had the tie back to cosmic order, and it had the notion of rebirth into the new age. So when you read section 76, think about the fact that it's not just ABC, let me think about three things that could refer to a kingdom A, a kingdom B, a kingdom C. The reference for the kingdoms are, in fact, celestial bodies of various descriptions, sun, moon, and stars. Smith then, in the Olive Leaf of 1832, at section 88 of the Utah Doctrine and Covenants, is the time that he next quite clearly takes up this topic. I've underlined and read, those of you that are enthusiasts for inscrutable holographs, and for those of you who are not, this is just typed and straight up. And it's worth remember that the Olive Leaf is a lot of things. It's the beginning of the Kirtland Temple. It's the beginning of the School of the Prophets. It's his announcement of the direction that the temple system would develop over the next years. And it's also a clarification of the vision, section 76 in the Utah Doctrine and Covenants. And he says in the Olive Leaf, there are many kingdoms, for there is no space in the which there is no kingdom, and there is no kingdom in which there is no space. Plenitude, right? All space is filled. There are no missing gaps. And then, gradation, either a greater or a lesser kingdom. Then, in the Olive Leaf, he moves to the parable of laborers. And the parable of laborers, you'll recall, is a New Testament parable that Jesus tells. And he talks about agricultural migrant, agricultural workers who come to pick a field, much as we would imagine happening in Florida or California today. And the person who had the money asked them to go out and work. And he asked all to work. Some started working early in the morning. Others started working at lunchtime. And others started working an hour before the close of business. And at the end, the owner of the vineyard paid them all an identical wage. Now, Jesus seems, according to most standard readings of the New Testament, to be indicating that it doesn't matter if you're lowly and late to the game. If you accept the kingdom, you'll be okay. And it was meant to tease people who felt like they were the ones who deserved the very best versus others. When Joseph Smith reads it, I apologize for the lovers of the holographs, but let's go to something a little bit more readable. He says, okay, this is what happens, right? There's an owner of a vineyard, and then there are people that work in the vineyard for him at different points through the day. And critically, it's different points of time. And time, not for us so much anymore, but for most of recorded human history, time was a question of astronomy. Time was a question of orbits and celestial bodies and our integration as human beings into the grand stage of cosmos, right? It's day or night because the earth is spinning, right? And the years change and the seasons change and we have winter because the earth is rotating around the sun. So when you talk about time, for these people and people before them, time indicated celestial bodies. And then he starts to talk about the fact that there will be every person, every man in his own order until his hour was finished, even according as his Lord had commanded him, that his Lord might be glorified in him, and he and his Lord, that they all might be glorified. So in this inversion of the parable, suggesting that they were told when they were supposed to come, you are the one that comes at noon, you are the one that comes at two, because there would be a gradation. And then he says, Therefore, under this parable, I will liken all these kingdoms. These kingdoms is referring back to the vision, section 76, and the inhabitants thereof, every kingdom in its hour, and in its time, and in its season. So he's returning to this notion that kingdoms, which are ways of talking about the post-mortal states of individual human beings, will all have their assigned times. In 1842, Joseph Smith had Wild Bill Phelps, one of my favorite heroes of the early Restoration, write a poetic version of the vision. Michael Hicks, a musicologist at BYU, wrote, I think, the definitive demonstration that this was ghostwritten by Phelps for Smith. And in it, Phelps was apologizing for his apostasy in Missouri and was also very excited about the concepts in Section 76. And when he went through and made it poetic, he came back to this astronomical cosmic image, and then he used this language. They all harmonize like the parts of a tune, right? It's important to recognize that harmony is central to the notion of the chain of being, and there is the music of the spheres. If people heard that, it's not little kids dressed in little birndles banging on little chimes. It's the music of the spheres is the notion that there is a music, and music was felt by the Greeks and many after them to represent that perfect harmony, that in some respects ineffable harmony. And when you get out to the spheres, to the higher orders of cosmic organization, there's a music that's associated with them. So when you talk about harmonizing like the parts of a tune, you're hearkening back to that notion of integration in the chain. And then the women and men of the Joseph Smith Papers Project have recently given us a wonderful Christmas present in the Book of the Law of the Lord and a very reliable transcription. When Joseph Smith in March 1842 is working on publishing the Book of Abraham in the Utah LDS Pearl of Great Price, he's talking again about what? About astronomy, about cosmology, and about order. And then, in a meeting in March 1842, actually, Wilford Woodruff's 35th birthday party, just pause for a moment, where my wife and I are hitting 40, and some of you, that's a memory. These scruffy youngsters were, barely old enough, we would think, to have kids or hold a job in there. We're doing all sorts of interesting stuff, so good for them. So at Wilford Woodruff's 35th birthday party, Joseph Smith explained many important principles in relation to progressive improvement in the scale of intelligent existence. The other thing you need to know is that the chain of being was also commonly called the scale of nature, scala naturae, or the scale of existence. So this is, in terms of actual invocation of language associated with the tradition, this is a smoking gun. The scale of intelligent existence is a reference to at least some version of the great chain of being. Now, the Sermon on the Grove, a lot of you will have heard about a sermon called the King Follett Discourse. It's actually not his funeral sermon. His funeral sermon was preached a month before that. But it's Joseph Smith's general conference address inspired by his reflections on King Follett. But what we call the King Follett Discourse is a general conference address about a month after the funeral sermon. And then when Joseph Smith preached what we now call the King Follett Discourse, there were a lot of people that were very irritated with it. And it was really quite distinctive in terms of American Protestantism. So the Sermon on the Grove, a short time later, a couple of months later, Joseph Smith returned to it and tried to get some clarity for people that were listening. This is for those of you that love orthography from the 19th century. This is for you that are children of the latter 20th. And here, it's hard. This is the bullet transcript of it, but we can think this through. It says, Paul says there is one glory of the sun, the moon, and the stars. That's pretty straightforward. 1 Corinthians 15, section 76, section 88 are all invoked here. And it's the notion that there is a cosmic scale that describes the degrees of gradation, or what they would have called probably degrees of glory, in the afterlife. And then he talks about how the stars, representing humans, differ from each other. That's what this pregnant ampersand here, right? The star differs, etc. Each star differs from the others in glory. And then he says, they, meaning humans, are exalted far above principalities, thrones, dominions, and angels. It's important to know that principalities, thrones, dominions were felt by most people through late antique, medieval, early modern, into the antebellum period to be references to orders of angels. We think principalities, thrones, and dominions now refer to some sort of secular power. But for many of Smith's readers, and I think probably for Joseph Smith as well, these were references to possible historical ideas about orders of angels. And then is explicit, right? They're higher than the angels. And then makes a reference to people being the heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, which is, again, beautiful Pauline language that's been repurposed here. So in the Sermon in the Grove, Smith again returns to this notion that there are relationships among people that are similar to what we thought of as the great chain of being. This brings us to what exactly it was. And it seems to be a familial version of the great chain of being. When Smith talked about the great chain of being, he meant the kindred of humans and angels, all interconnected in a grand, beautiful, large family that was itself what the chain of being was nodding toward. And when he reveals sealing, and if you go back and read what he writes about sealing and binding and temple, he's talking about your adoption into this chain of belonging through the temple priesthood that he was revealing to be a part of that. And the crucial conceptual infrastructure that he used to communicate his notions about the interconnections of all humans were the great chain genealogized, familialized, turned into the kindred. And when you hear them talk about the perfect chain from Father Adam to his latest posterity, those are the echoes you ought to be hearing. Those are the echoes they would have heard. Thinking about dominion, this Hiram's brother-in-law, there are a lot of in-laws in early Mormonism, it turns out. A man's dominion will be as God's is over his own creatures, and the more numerous, the greater his dominion. The degrees of heaven reflected, this is my prose now, that the degrees of heaven in this chain of belonging were not merit or ontological superiority. It wasn't a statement about the difference between a sea anemone and a fish. It was a statement about the ways we connect to each other, and the model he was invoking was a parental model. And his argument was that no matter who we are, we have the right and the privilege to participate in tender relationships of parent and child in both directions, all the way back to the beginning of humanity, all the way to the end of humanity. Brigham Young then uses language that's been quoted variably. It's an interesting, Brigham, who is an ancestor of mine, had a creative way of speaking. I'm going to plug here a buddy's biography of Brigham Young, John Turner, Harvard Press. It's coming out, I think, in July. He's a Presbyterian religious historian at University of Alabama and writes it clearly from an outsider perspective, I think a very balanced academic work. And it helps you understand a little bit more about Brigham Young's creative mouth. So he doesn't always say exactly what he means, and it's important not to chase every literal thing Brigham Young ever said. But he makes a sort of argument that says that your status, right, calling back to chain of being, right, it's humans, it's superhumans, there are 36 or 9 or 100 different orders of superhuman entities. He says, look, it's not that. It's not that you're a little lower than an archangel who's higher than a principality. It's that you got kids. Those kids are the people over whom you are or over whom you exist in this chain of belonging. And you are the children of someone else. And what's interesting here is the centrality of the parent-child relationship and the separation of that parent-child relationship from mandatory biology. Joseph Smith didn't believe that if you were infertile, you would never have children in an earthly sense. But he argued that you could adopt, that you could create relationships even without biologically giving birth that could constitute those. And that the paradigm of relationships toward which we ought to strive are the relationship between Jesus and God, which was a child and a parent. This is generally attributed to Orson Hyde. This is a diagram of the kingdom of God. This is the crown representing God. There's been an argument that is, to my eye, wholly unconvincing, that this is a Kabbalistic Keter Elyon, the crown of God, and that this is meant to be the Sephirot, but I think that's a fundamental misreading. What I do think it's an accurate reading of, though, is the chain of belonging as modulated through Brigham Young's genealogical and divine arithmetic. So I wanted to show you the kernels of my chain of belonging. These are my sibs and my wonderful mother. And this is all the other kids that have come from complexity. The thing I didn't have time to do as I threw the talk together today was to then take it to the next step, which I think Joseph Smith requires, which is that the family of heaven is beyond simple biological associations. That for those of us that are embedded in a church congregation, for those of us that are embedded in a geographical neighborhood or a state or a guild or the modern equivalent to it, those individuals could also constitute members of that great chain of belonging. That's it.
Questions? Do you dare?
So we know that Joseph Smith was sealing non-familial members.
Correct.
And that changes with Wilford Woodruff. What do you think about that change? That Joseph thought you could seal people and make that sealing the equivalent of a family relationship. Why does Wilford decide that that system is going to work?
Can you hear that back there?
I'll repeat. Okay. The question is, it's known that Joseph Smith authorized and encouraged modes of being sealed to other people that were not your biological kin. And to put a fine point on it, the formal rites of adoption are actually from Young after Smith's death. But there's no doubt that Young was merely implementing what Smith had elaborated. Then in 1894, as I recall, Wilford Woodruff put an end to the ritual of adoption. And the question is, well, what does it mean exactly for Woodruff to have put an end to it? My first answer is two words, Jonathan Stapley. Stapley wrote a wonderful treatment of adoption theology in Mormonism from about 46 through the modern day. And I think does a very good job of contextualizing that. That's in Journal of Mormon History this year, recently. And I think he posted on the web. I bet it's on his SSRN webpage or on Common Consent. I would read that. It'll give you great sense. My personal answer, which is really only my amplification of very powerful arguments that Jonathan makes, is that Joseph Smith pointed toward a complex ideal that was exceedingly difficult to translate into actual practice. And what the saints found as they tried to live out this image is that people are people and we live in a fallen world. So you had people like John D. Lee campaigning for more adoptive kin and then was sort of a jerk. I mean, I don't mean to judge him. We're all jerks. But he was a little more on the jerk side than the rest of us. And not just because of this Mountain Meadows debacle. He was sort of a rough guy. And John D. Lee was commonly invoked, in part because he was very angry with Brigham Young for giving him up in the aftermath of Mountain Meadows and said, I am your son. How could you possibly do that? And then would also try to get more people after him. So there are several examples that Jonathan adduces of people trying to get more adoptive children to be the cool person, right? It's the fancier clothes, the fancier car, just in a different mode of communication. The other element is that as it evolved over the 19th century, people used the notion that they had unreliable ancestors as the reason that you needed to be tied in. Now remember, no link in the chain can be missing. That's from the chain of being, and that's also from the chain of belonging. There had to be an uninterrupted chain all the way back. And in the mid-19th century, people said, well, you got to be sealed to somebody of moment here now, because you don't know whether your triple great grandparents are going to accept the gospel. And Wilford Woodruff said, come on, they're going to accept the gospel. So he has this great language where he says, they're going to accept the gospel, don't worry about it. In part because he wanted to recognize, I think, the love that people feel more naturally for their biological ancestors. But in part a recognition that it's very hard for any of us to maintain the kinds of commitment to others that come pretty naturally to us for our biological kin. And, you know, it's an ongoing process, an ongoing dance. And some would say that Woodruff's revelation in 94 really sets the stage for the drift toward the proto-Victorian familial nuclei that are very different from what the chain of belonging suggested. And I suspect there will be a swing back as we all, not all of us are Latter-day Saints, I'm sorry, I'm talking in sort of an LDS mind, but it's true of all of us, whether there's God or not, we're all trying to figure out what on earth we do and how we make difficult choices among those that are presented to us and how we declare our allegiances to people that are fundamentally as good as we are. But that's, I would read Jonathan's, that's good.
I hear some people today who are working a lot in genealogy and family who say it really doesn't matter who you're sealed to as long as you're sealed, as long as you're part of the system. So it seems to kind of tie you a little bit.
That, I think, would fit very well with what Joseph Smith was proposing. And he seemed, this can be very interesting. It almost seemed like what he was saying most was that you be connected. Not that you be the fancy pants Jonathan Edwards II. Edwards was the famous Puritan preacher who's probably the greatest rock star of evangelical Protestantism in America. It's not a question of whether you're somebody of Edwards' stature, theologically or morally. It's a question of whether you're connected and committed. And I think that there's a paradox here, right? Because our connections are so intimately particular. Right? There are things that you know about the people that you love that are so specific you can't imagine the same relationship without them. But at the same time, what seems to matter most is just the general willingness to commit and to be connected that exists. Phil and Joyce Coons superintended my mission in southern Louisiana 5 or 2 years ago. And I'm delighted to see them. And Jim McConkie was my father's best friend for decades. So
we don't see any of this sort of thing in the Book of Mormon. It's kind of a more of a traditional Protestant viewpoint there. What kind of influences led Joseph Smith to develop these ideas?
I think you can make a lot of different arguments in this domain. One argument you could make is that this is a reminder that the Book of Mormon was not, for those who believe this is true, that the Book of Mormon was not something that Joseph created. That the Book of Mormon, there's a lot of room for lots of different types of arguments, but I think you could make an argument that Smith, before and after the Book of Mormon, is thinking about these kinds of things. But the Book of Mormon doesn't really contain them. One way of interpreting it is that the Book of Mormon is something external to Joseph Smith, and it's an influence on him, but it's not solely his creation.
What evidence is there that he was thinking about this prior to 1830?
That's a great and fair question. I'm not seeing anything from his pen that seems unaware of this kind of ideational structure. And it was very common in his cultural milieu. So I would be surprised if there was no evidence for it. Now, in fairness, you could push back, and I would say, fair enough, I'm moving a bit beyond the evidence. But these broad concepts that are called Hermeticism, Neoplatonism, Western Esotericism, Folk Esotericism, Traditional Religion, Folk Religion. I mean, there's a, choose a word that's been associated with these sorts of phenomena culturally. It was pretty robustly a part of growing up in the early 19th century in America. So that's why I think that's probably the case. As far as what gets him there, I think Phelps clearly is very interested in this, and he meets Phelps in 31, but so is Pratt.
How about Sidney Rigdon?
You know, it's interesting. Sidney Rigdon was an interesting fellow. I have not seen in Rigdon's writing as much of this. I think Rigdon saw himself as a Reformed Baptist and a preacher of substantial erudition. And other than his near obsession with spiritual gifts, what we might call charismatic gifts or exercises, or what is speaking in tongues and dynamic worship, like the, so those images of Sarah Palin at her Assemblies of God church, that Rigdon was very committed to those sorts of expressions. But other than that, he was a pretty straightforward Protestant thinker. There's a few hints of it in the early Rigdon that I've seen, but not as much. Not as much as you see in Phelps and the Pratt brothers. It's possible that it was Phelps and Pratt. I think one model of revelation, it's a model that I would feel comfortable with, is that revelation is something that happens contextually. And the contexts are not just your moment in time and your geography. Your context is the people that have gathered together. For Utah LDS, there's been a recent emphasis on council. Focus on council is not just one single figure. And I think that, in some respects, is a return to what probably was going on with a lot of early revelation, that the revelations are happening contextually. So it's entirely possible that Phelps says, hey, have you thought about this? And Smith says, well, yeah, oh, that's interesting, and sort of pulled it and put it together. As far as speaking formally as in from the historical academic perspective, I think you would invoke the American metaphysical folk religion, and you would argue that Phelps and Pratt are present very early in Smith's experience. And I think you get a little less traction from Sidney Rigdon. But there's no doubt that Sidney was aware.